Osio Nagada, it's good to see you all. I'm always struck about how to begin these talks, Chief. There needs to be a strong opening statement that's made. And I guess I'll draw on a great Cherokee by the name of Will Rogers, who once said that all I know is what I read in the newspaper. And I'm still old school. I go out every morning with a sharp stick out to the driveway and I turn the paper over to see if I'm the obituary section or not. And then I immediately go to my horoscope. And it's not because I really believe in any of that, but I'm just curious about what it says. And I brought the paper, A, to prove I was not in the obituary, and then secondly, to read my horoscope. I'm a Cancer, I'm a Crab, I'm a Moon Child. I was born in July. And this one caught my eye. It said, "The light of wisdom cannot get into a heart that has never been broken. The cracks are what makes illumination possible. Wisdom may not make you feel better now, but it will help you make better choices later." That's what I believe we're all here about, is living out the choices that people with broken hearts, the choices that they may have made. A recent visit by my only sister, L.D., and her husband, Tom, are the beginnings of my talk today. They just retired from 25-plus years as educators who have lived away from their childhood communities. My brother-in-law, Tom, for him, Tahlequah has changed a great deal over the past 40 years since his family operated Eller's Last Chance grocery store there on the town's north side. And my sister, L.D., well, a visit to our family homestead on the verdant landscape of Mosley's Prairie shows what less invasive development can do over the years. Yes, it's only a short 3-mile drive to the Cherokee Casino in West Siloam. And yes, there's much more availability of electricity, running water, and indoor bathrooms than when we grew up there on Mosley's Prairie. On what had been called the James Ward Childs Allotment in the old Going Snake District of the Cherokee Nation. But in many ways, it's unchanged landscape. And exactly as the old settlers before and the newly arrived immigrants huddled at Bushy Head Depot just 10 miles away would have seen Mosley's Prairie as they began their transition from arrival points along the Arkansas border to the nation's interior in 1839. From our family farm in Adair County, the road continues on south to Carnes Ford on the Illinois River, and then southwest toward Chewy. The road will take you past the site of the old Mitchell store and an elbow of the Illinois River, across from Zeke Proctor's farm. And an earlier Mitchell operated a grist mill there long before 1844, when Mr. Towers transported his French-made corn and wheat burr stones purchased in New Orleans, which he brought up the Mississippi, which he brought up the Arkansas to Fort Smith, and then by ox cart to be taken to a site on Flint Creek in the Going Snake District of the Cherokee Nation. And it was there, just a quarter of a mile from Flint Creek's confluence with the Illinois River, that Towers established a grist mill that would change owners across the 19th century to names like Hildebrand and Beck. And yes, even Zeke Proctor would be a name attached forever with that mill and its history. But that's a story for another day. My sister said she came home because she had been juried into the tribal art show for the Cherokee holiday. And there she would showcase her cultural interpretations in fused and slumped glass. And we did attend artist receptions in Tahlequah and Park Hill, there in the shadow of our Cherokee granny's alma mater, the Agea Junta Skolsti. How did I do, Bobby? Yeah, what's that? The place where the big girls learn, right? Holstein. It was there that the big girls went to learn, and it was there that we still go to learn. But I genuinely believe that she came home not for the art show, rather to spend a full week driving the roads of our native Adair County, a place named for one of our Cherokee grandfathers and a place where we grew up with the stories of our people, where they came to cultivate a cultural garden so that our roots might take hold in that rocky soil of the Ozark uplift. Yes, we drove to Chewy. And standing at the old store just east of the Skelly School and just west of ancient stomp grounds, we marveled at a hand-painted sign that announced that on the second Saturday night of each month there would be Native American professional wrestling at the Chewy Community Center. And more astonishing, we discovered that the river road to the Crittenden Cemetery across from the Illinois Baptist Church was now paved. We drove up the river and we stood at the old home site of Still Jackson, where my great aunt Minnie Jackson lived for many, many, many years. A place where tribal counselor Jack Baker's uncle Mick Hogshooter taught me how to dress a deer. I baled a lot of hay in those fields and I scanned fresh plowed fields for ancient projectile points, and I hand fished in the shallows below the bust of the Illinois River. My sister LD and I walked the fields of home and we were flooded with memories as thick as the humidity on a late August day in Oklahoma. We told stories of our childhood as we drove the back roads of Adair County, and we were young again. And our grandpas and grannies, long dead and past, were just as alive as when they kept us upon their knees with stories of how we came to be here in this place. Back on Mosley's Prairie, my sister spent an entire day cleaning the headstones of those family members whose lives were defined by this little piece of the Cherokee Nation. They rest at Johnson Cemetery, just north of the Adair, Delaware County line and west of the dividing point between Arkansas and the sovereignty of the Cherokee Nation. I dropped her off in an early afternoon one day with her brushes, soaps, and an ample supply of spring water, and returned in late afternoon to see the product of her work. Names and dates were clear now, and so were the memories. We walked among the old ones in respectful remembrance so that we could acknowledge the product of their work. At the center of Johnson Cemetery is a sprawling oak tree that no doubt competed at one stage in its life, its 100 plus year life, in a race with which would be tallest, the tree or Zeke Proctor's headstone. We stood next to the headstones of the cemetery's first occupant, patriarch of the Cherokee Proctors, William Proctor, born 1796, far to the east, and casting his lot among the Cherokees, would travel west of the Mississippi and was laid to rest for the last time here in that spot in 1853. The kin of the Proctors are well represented at Johnson Cemetery. There are Mitchells and Downings and Acorns, many emblazed with Trail of Tears Association badges proclaiming that they had made the walk and survived. Among these ancient stones, written in both English and Cherokee, as a young boy, I walked on decoration days with my grandparents, who used these headstones as though they were modern iPads. They taught the history and the culture of our people. As the sun began to settle in for a good rest in the west, my sister LD said something that brought to me the title of today's talk: Cellular Memory West of the Mississippi. And no, I'm not talking about cell phones. Rather, a more genetic definition of the word. For you see, my sister is a retired educator. She holds a master's degree in molecular biology from Washington State University. And as we walked among the headstones of our ancestors and extended family, she said, "There is a comfort in coming here. After all, at the cellular level, we are carrying their memories, and while they are distant echoes, they are just as alive and present today as they were during the Trail of Tears, alive and present. She said they were alive and present. I live in Norman, Oklahoma today with the lovely Mrs. Hannah. She's a girl that grew up in Tahlequah. I work in downtown Oklahoma City, and my daily commute is a far different drive than a gravel road to Chewy. It is a commute that allows me, though, to indulge in my daily ritual of listening to National Public Radio. And for those of you who have taken a taste of NPR, you know that their stories often take a unique turn and are more prone to discuss the migration of monarch butterflies than to provide a breakdown on a college football standing. My sister's remarks about cellular memory nudged my recollection of a drive time story on NPR. The story reported how a new study had found that moths and butterflies may be more intelligent than scientists believe. Moths can remember things that they learned when they were caterpillars. And even though the transformation process of metamorphosis essentially turns their brains and bodies to a cellular soup, it can remember lessons learned when the moths were caterpillars, before the trauma of metamorphosis. Now, we all learned in seventh grade biology that caterpillars don't just change their clothes when they turn into moths or butterflies. Instead, they go through a biological meltdown that reduces them to literally a cellular soup. And professor and biologist Martha Weiss said, what we learned is that caterpillars turn into kind of a minestrone, and that those ingredients that make up caterpillars are completely reorganized into butterflies. Caterpillars throw away the leftovers that they didn't need from the soup, and they transform into a new creature. Weiss studies butterflies and moths inside of a tiny laboratory, the article went on the campus of Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. Her lab holds a lot of big green caterpillars that eventually turn into tobacco hornworm moths, and it also has a research team with canisters of foul-smelling gas called ethyl acetate. And they have boxes that are rigged to zap the caterpillars with electric shocks. Seems like an odd combination, but I was intrigued. Even though my commute was over, I was in my driveway listening. The question that they asked is, can a moth or butterfly remember something that it learned as a caterpillar? So the research put a lot of big green tobacco hornworm caterpillars into electric boxes and then gave them a whiff of this stinky gas, and then they zapped them so that the caterpillars would get a bit of the smell and they get a bit of the shock. And you can tell that they noticed the shock. They did it once an hour for 8 hours. Yeah, cruel to caterpillars, I guess. Weiss says that caterpillars quickly learned that the stench would be followed by a jolt. And as a result, the caterpillars would not go near anything that smelled of ethyl acetate. Now, next, the researchers would let the caterpillars start the process that would turn them into moths. One by one, the caterpillars disappeared into their brown, urn-shaped pupation chambers and dissolved their bodies and their brains. And 5 weeks later, the moth hatched out. At that point, the researchers would give the moth a choice of fresh air or air with the stank of ethyl acetate. And wouldn't you know it, the moths that had learned to avoid ethyl acetate at larva still avoided it as adults. In other words, somehow, caterpillar memories had survived the biological meltdown. Weiss and her co-authors report on the results in a journal published in the Public Library of Science. And by some accounts, it's kind of work that eventually helps experts on the human brain and how to learn more about damaged neurons sometimes fix themselves. It looks like moths are smarter than we think. Now, it's true, they're not good at crossword puzzles, and they're not very good at calculus. But they can make connections that are relevant to their lives They make connections that are relevant to their lives. For example, they know which red flowers are poisonous ones, and they know where the safest place is to lay their eggs. Now, after hearing that NPR story, my sister's remarks there at Johnson Cemetery, I began to ponder on these. If cellular memory exists in moths, then why not in other living creatures? Perhaps even humans. Now, before you get worried that we're about to swerve off into a treatise on epigenetic mechanics and the cellular and physiological phenotypical trait variations that are caused by external and environmental factors which switch genes on and off inside of beings, causing them to change their DNA sequence. Well, let's just say that I got that lecture at Johnson Cemetery from my sister. Apparently, we are wearing our ancestors' genes, which might cause us to make connections that are relevant in our lives. And just as caterpillars were conditioned to the smell of ethyl acetate with an electric shock, I would suggest here today that if ever there were an indelible shock upon a society, a culture, a tribe of people, that would create a durable cellular memory, the Trail of Tears was most certainly that event. Now, unlike my sister, I'm a banker. And I'm a businessman, and I read business books. One of my reads a few years back paralleled this genetic connectedness and resonates with me today. Malcolm Gladwell, in his book Outliers, The Story of Success, stated it plainly. What's the question we always ask about the successful? We want to know what they're like. What kind of personalities they have, or how intelligent that they are, or what kind of lifestyles that they have, or what special talents that they might have been born with, and we assume that it is those personal qualities that explain how individuals reach the top. He goes on to say that in Outliers, I want to convince you that these kinds of personal explanations of success don't work. People don't rise from nothing. We do owe something to patronage and to parentage. The people who stand before kings may look as though they did it themselves, but in fact, they are inevitably the beneficiaries of hidden advantages and extraordinary opportunities and cultural legacies that allow them to learn and work hard and make sense of the world in ways that others cannot. It makes a difference where and when you grew up. Lessons of life relevance. It does make a difference where and where you were born. It certainly did for the Cherokee ancestors and for the ancestors that we have of the other tribes that were removed to the west. Their being situated in the southeast placed them on a collision course with an exponentially enveloping expansion of European population. Well, one might say that even being in the right place at the wrong time still has wrong connected to it. The Cherokees' placement west of the Alleghenies and beyond the Appalachian, and their time in history, and their affable acceptance of crown traders who were as much agents of change as were the government agents, missionaries, and treaty emissaries that would follow, they mattered then, and I would say that they matter now. Those who came among us would do much more then gift European surnames like Adair, Starr, Bench, Ward, Thompson, Smith, still upon the Cherokees. They would cause an acculturation that is a bright weave within our nation's tapestry even today. When the two Moravians, Steiner and Schwinitz, joined journey through the Cherokee country in 1799 seeking to establish a mission station, they wrote that the Cherokees had greatly increased in culture and civilization in the last few years. But in the course of the last summer,
300 plows and as many pairs of cotton carding combs had been sent to this nation, and they had begun to devote themselves to agriculture, and the raising of cotton had several times brought cotton for sale as they had themselves begun to spin and weave. And plows beget textbooks at the Moravian Mission at Spring Place in 1801 and later at Brainerd Mission, established in 1817 near present-day Chattanooga by the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missionaries. These served as a preface to the annual appropriation of $10,000 provided by Congress in 1819 via the Civilization Fund in the support of Indian education, including tools and plows at parity with books and writing paper. These efforts introduced a European approach to land use. More than just a manifestation of Article 14 of the 1791 Treaty of Holston, which officially encouraged the Cherokees to become farmers, it provided a path for the Cherokee people to embrace a metamorphosis of their economy and thus a metamorphosis of their culture. We are told that when a group of resident missionaries met at New Echota in December of 1830, that they issued a statement that included a report on the agricultural progress of the Cherokees. It is noted that 30 years ago, a plow was scarcely seen in the nation. 20 years ago, there were nearly 500, since the ground was cultivated chiefly by hoe only. 6 years ago, the number of plows as enumerated was 2,923. Trade and commerce were facilitated by mixed-blood population that was coming of age in both economic and political prowess at a critical juncture in the timeline of the Cherokee Nation. A maturing infrastructure of sawmills, grist mills, blacksmith shops, stores, ferries, and one of the most perhaps important changes was evidenced in the number of livestock that the Cherokees had acquired by the second decade of the 19th century, which numbered nearly 80,000 head. And to move people and product, the good roads that traversed the nation would ironically be the very path that thousands would use to depart to the West. Observations of the time indicate that there were more than 6,000 privately owned dwellings and outbuildings mirroring the significance of agrarian operations at the dawn of the decade of 1830. Each of these were evidence that the Cherokees had become a burgeoning nation of unique pan-cultural profile. You add in Sequoia's creation of the syllabary to enable literacy, a focus on education for all classes, a free press, and the evolution toward a constitutional government. Add these into the economic and cultural mix, and you have a recipe that produces a level of progress, and dare I say civilization, that for the Cherokees endured both harmony and jealousy of their neighbors. Once gold was discovered in Aurora, Georgia in 1829, the beginning of the end had arrived. All told, you now have what my sister, the molecular biologist, would recall from her study of chemistry as the synergistic effect, where harmless elements combine to make a volatile concoction. And that volatile concoction was removal. While the Indian Removal Act of 1830 was the fuel, the accelerant was most certainly the administration of Andrew Jackson. There's not enough time in this entire week to examine the conflicted foibles of a man who paternalistically referred to Indians as his children, postured that removal was the way to protect their way of life, and at the same time defied the Supreme Court, ignored federal law, and indulged in his own political avarice by pandering to Southern legislators who demanded Indian removal by force if necessary. It's estimated that as many as 100,000 American Indians were removed from the eastern homelands west of the Mississippi during the first half of the 19th century, and this number may well be an underestimation. Winnebagoes ceded their homelands in Wisconsin. Potawatomis surrendered the Great Lakes regions. Natives of East Coast were absorbed or removed. At the end of Jackson's administration, the War Department officials had negotiated nearly 70 Indian treaties, with an overwhelming majority of them involving land secession. This record would never be eclipsed. Jackson's administration had relocated 46,000 natives by 1837 and established a schedule for removal beyond his term for almost as many, virtually eradicating the native population of what we know as the eastern United States. And while his rhetoric was oftentimes taken to task by critics, domestic and foreign, for his no holds barred, just like in Chewy on a Saturday night, negotiation with native leaders, statesman Henry Clay, Frelinghuys, senators, envoys, visiting explorers and ethnographers ranging from Featherstone Hall to Alex Tocqueville, still, Andrew Jackson pressed forward an agenda with the centerpiece of immigration focused on the Choctaws in 1831, Creeks in 1836, Seminoles in 1836, although they did not go quietly. It may have been 1840 before they were removed west of the Mississippi. Chickasaws in 1837, and the Cherokees from 37 to 39. And again, much has been said here today and could be said about the unwitting aid given to the Jackson administration by the Cherokees themselves. Internal conflicts over a formula for survival as a nation was a pitched debate that would resound into the post-removal era with more than heated words. Assassinations and reprisal would be a cancer that would eat away at the very fiber of the Cherokee Nation well past the American Civil War. Many of you know I've often spoke of the role of my grandmother's family played in the treaty parties parley with the federal government, siding with the Ridges at New Echota. The stars and the bells were conspicuous in the decision making that told the end of the Cherokees in the East, and whether they were simply an emerging Cherokee mixed blood gentry without the same level of political clout that the tribe's aristocracy found within the Ross Party, or perhaps they were simply looking out for their own material interests over those of what so many writers referred to as the common Indian. They were a group easily identified in the enumeration of the nation's assets of cultivation, livestock, and merchant holdings. Or then again, maybe they were assembled as headmen in December of 1835 at New Echota to take the only viable choice to retain the nation in corporate in a new home beyond the Mississippi. I have yet to decide. Thus, I have settled on neither defending nor denigrating their actions, for their times were their own, and no man can live beyond his time. What we do know is that when 360 Cherokees started overland in 1837, led by government guide D.B. Cannon, crossing the Hiawassee River at Calhoun, Georgia on October the 14th, their march of 15 to 20 miles a day would take them over a northern route to this river and this place. That the realities of rhetoric would resonate in the words of George B. Burnett, a Tennessee soldier who spoke Cherokee, and who had been sent to the Smoky Mountain country as an interpreter. Later, he would refer to the removal as the execution of the most brutal order in the history of American warfare. By May of 1838, 4,000 U.S. regulars, 3,000 volunteers under the command of General Winfield Scott marched into Indian country and wrote what has been called the blackest chapter on the palettes of American history. The Trail of Tears Conference has one of the greatest assemblages of scholars, writers, and thinkers to be brought together in examination of the events, people, issues, and the product of forced removal, not just for the Cherokees, rather entire Native cultures that fell victim to the final solution contemplated in the Indian Removal Act of 1830. It is right that scholars and laymen alike assemble on the west bank of the Mississippi to both passionately and dispassionately examine the history and the legacy of the removal period. Good scholarship examines both sides of issues at hand, and we should allow a moment of scholarship during these coming days. At the same time, we must remember this is not just the curiosity of history. It is an examination of humanity. And it is a humanity that is just as alive and present today as it was during those crossings. Now, I know I've attempted to connect several dots and maybe even a few squares here today. Some of these connections align logically and some need dressing, just as did the burr stones at Mr. Towers' mill on Flint Creek 171 years ago. But in the end, Malcolm Gladwell was right when he wrote that it makes a difference where and when you grew up. As Cherokees today, we are descended from a people who were victims of both external and internal forces. I would suggest that we should be listening for our cellular memory. And what we should be listening for is not a lesson of victimization, rather a lesson of perseverance as a people. We do have a choice. We can either focus on remembering the sting of removal, or we can focus on remembering that we are a people and a nation of durability. The government of the Cherokee Nation in 1838 did in many ways turn into a metamorphic soup. The old Cherokee Nation dissolved in the East, much like the caterpillar in the NPR story. And keeping with that analogy, the nation was transformed in that metamorphosis. Still, it carried through the transformation and brought a knowledge and relevance hard purchased that was the DNA required to make a new nation in the West. The Cherokee Nation transformed into a constitutional government with courts, schools, and commerce that would be tested again and again by internal and external forces. Today, armed with our fourth written constitution, an evolving commitment to language and culture, we must keep strong our pledge to embrace our tribalness, treasuring our elders, safeguarding our children, returning to a tradition of consensus in our councils, holding our chiefs accountable for the framing and implementation of a vision for today and tomorrow's Cherokee Nation. These things, I believe, must be the true legacy of the Trail of Tears. This week, others will no doubt speak of Cannon's Rout and the subsequent Cherokee-led detachments that faced winter's wrath, ice and snow, sickness, and that expansive barrier that the Ojibwa called the Mississippi, meaning the Great River. This place is within our cellular memory. For a moment in our history, this river erased political and factional separation between old settlers, Ross Party, and Treaty Party, for you see, my friends, this river we all had to cross. A few years ago, I delivered the keynote at this organization's annual conference in Gunnersville, Alabama, a place where another of my Cherokee grandfathers, John Binge, led the Cherokee detachment across Gunter's Landing on the Tennessee River in October of 1838. And here today, in Cape Girardeau, I returned to be in the shadow of another Cherokee grandfather, George Still, His Cherokee name was Sigatogi. I think it means he still stands. He still stands. As assistant conductor of the Moses Daniel Detachment, George still struggled with the death of his wife, Katie Downing, on the trail. And he endeavored to protect his children and indeed all in his care who left the agency camp at Calhoun, Georgia on September 20th of 1838 with just over 1,000 souls on their way west of the Mississippi. I know this because my grandfather Tom Hanna, son of Julie Still, who was the daughter of Black Still, who was the son of Samuel Still, who was the son of Jack Still, who was the son of wagon master Sigatogi Still, George Still, he still stands. My grandfather told me so. Tom Hanna sleeps on Mosley's Prairie at Johnson Cemetery, a place where I walk among the old ones and I remember. Or do we remember through them? Sigatogi, he still stands. As long as we keep our culture, he does indeed still stand. Our ancestors were uprooted from their ancestral lands, the birthplace of their culture, in the very cradle of their coming of existence. Uprooted and forcibly moved to the west beyond the Mississippi in 1838 and 1839, the shock of removal upon our culture was just as real as an experiment in a Georgetown laboratory. Our ancestors had that memory indelibly etched upon them. And if my sister's theory and that of the good Professor Wise from the NPR story are correct, perhaps we carry within our tribal being a vivid imprint of the removal. And perhaps it is those genetic echoes that offer connections that are relevant in our lives today. Maybe that's one of the driving forces that causes us to gather here this week in this historic and significant place where they cross this mighty river into the west. If butterflies and moths derive relevance from the cocoon, then we too must search and keep relevance in our lives, learning from generations ago. We must listen from within and focus on the lessons of the past, lessons learned about how to avoid intertribal divisiveness, confliction within our government, our communities, and our families. These lessons of the past are just as relevant in a modern time. This is our role here this week. We should listen for the reverb of our ancestral legacy and their lessons indelibly stamped upon our culture. We should share, ponder, deliberate on causes and consequences of the removal. But we should not come to this river as descendants of victims. We must embrace the tenacity of those who walked on this trail where they cried, so that our nation, our culture, our language, and our tribe will do just as they who walked had intended when they reached this side of the river, to keep the Cherokee Nation alive and present. Alive and present west of the Mississippi for future generations. To the Trail of Tears Association, to its members and friends, and indeed all those who have gathered in this place, I would extend to you an uli halesti, an honored welcome, for your good work to indelibly mark these trails for future generations and thus keep our story relevant in our lives today. I would simply say, wa done. Thank you all. Dita Yolahan Daglaniska.